الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وعظيمنا وزعيمنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته، اللهم آمين. إن شاء الله we are still continuing to cover the issue we have been covering for several weeks, and that is the good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How our manners should be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today we are going to focus on what prophets used to have of manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because those are the guides. Those are the people that were chosen by God, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to lead us and to show us the way. So their manners with Allah are the best, and we ought to learn from their ways. You see, in the story of Prophet Noah alayhi salam, when he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, ride in the ship, you and your family. So when the ship was made and everybody was jumping on board, he found that his son is going to drown. So he goes to Allah, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنَّ بِنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي. Oh Allah, my son is from my family. Logic. وَإِنَّ وَعْدَكَ الْحَقِّ, and your promise is always good. You always make good on your promise. I trust that. Look at the introduction. He is using Allah's promise to appeal to Allah's mercy. وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ, and you are the most merciful of those who are merciful. Look at this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers him. He says, no. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ. No. He is not of your family. Now the Quran is going to define family as the family of believers, not the blood relatives. I want you to pay attention. Family is your believing brothers and sisters in the community, those who believe in Allah, those who believe in the books, in the prophets, in the hereafter, and live by what they believe. Those are your family. We know in the story also of Noah that his wife, which is typically named as family in the language of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala names her as an example of those who disbelieved. He made her an example, as he made Maryam, Mary, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, the mother of Jesus, an example of the believers. He made the wife of Lot and the wife of Nuh as the epic disbelief examples. So the definition of family in the Quran is not limited to blood. In fact, it goes beyond that. And from the statement in this interaction, this communication, when Allah says he is not of your family, Allah sets a line that if there is a competition between a blood family and the family of the family of the faithful takes precedent. This is what it is. So, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ, he is not of your family. And then he says, فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ. Don't ask me of things and about things that you have no knowledge of. Allah has a plan and his plan will be executed and that story will stand until the day of judgment to be a story to reflect upon. So Allah wants to teach Nuh a lesson and through him teach us also a lesson that we should understand. So his son apparently is not a young baby. We're talking hundreds of years in age. But again, Nuh is a father. So he wants his son saved. But Allah has a different plan according to his wisdom and according to his knowledge. So إنه ليس من أهلك إنه عمل غير صالح. And in another recitation, إنه عمل غير صالح. Either that he is not a good deed, he himself is not a good deed, or that what he's doing doesn't qualify him to be saved because it's not good deed. So the lesson here is people are saved by Allah based on their actions, not their lineage. Now the point about good manners. Nuh comes back to Allah in repentance, seeking forgiveness. قال رب إني أعوذ بك أن أسألك ما ليس لي به علم. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you that I may ever ask you whatever I have no knowledge of. So he completely submits to Allah's presentation. He tells him, this son is not of your family. Nuh doesn't ask anymore about his son. He's asking about Allah's forgiveness. وَإِلَّا تَغْفِرْ لِي وَتَرْحَمْنِي أَكُنْ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Unless you forgive me and bestow your mercy upon me, I will be among the losers. Look at the adab, the etiquette, the manners, the great manners of a prophet who is leading his community towards Allah. He is not using his work to tell Allah, oh Allah, but or if, what about? No, there is no back and forth with Allah. This is the majesty of Allah, and this is how you glorify Allah. When you read his word, you just take it, understand it, absorb it, and live by it. Don't argue with Allah. Many of us, unfortunately, we read the Quran and immediately the shaitan throws ideas at us and we'll start arguing with Allah. I hope that Allah didn't say this. I hope he said that. I hope that this had come in this place, not in this place. I was looking for this ayah in that surah, not in this surah. As if we are running a review of what Allah has already sent down. This is not good manners with Allah. So Nuh is asking Allah to forgive him for asking Allah to save his son without knowing the knowledge he needs to have. Just lack of knowledge made him feel ashamed to ask. So now he's asking for Allah's forgiveness. But you look at the level of submission and the level of commitment and the level of discipline, you understand you are listening to a prophet. That's an example. You look at Ibrahim. Ibrahim had a lengthy discussion with his father, who used to be an idol worshiper. And his father condemned him and disowned him and rejected him. And he told him, if you don't quit, I'm going to stone you to death. Mind you, Ibrahim at that time was a young man. Ibrahim was commissioned as a young man. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُشْدَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَكُنَّا بِهِ عَالِمِينَ. We have given Ibrahim his full-fledged maturity at young age. When he destroyed the stones and they asked each other, the idol worshippers, who did this? They said what? سَمِعْنَا فَتًا يَذْكُرُهُمْ يُقَالُ لَهُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. We've heard a young man mentioning them. His name is Ibrahim. Young man? Yes, fata in Islam, teenager. You are talking about teenager standing strong. Why? Because he believes in Allah and he trusts Allah to take care of him. Ibrahim never argues with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never once. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. As Allah told him, submit, he said, I am in submission to you, O Allah. I submit to you. His impulsive, rational, instantaneous answer was, I submit. Allah says, you submit. He says, I submit. How many times does Allah ask us in the Quran, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. Are you going to submit? Are you going to quit what I forbid you from doing? Do we hear that? Do we answer Allah as the prophets answered Allah? إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. But not only himself. وَوَصَّى بِهَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ بَنِيهِ وَيَعْقُوبُ. And he admonished his children, Ibrahim and Yaqub, Jacob, Israel. They both admonished their children to worship none but Allah. This is beyond the call of duty. He asked him to submit, and he goes beyond himself to make sure that his children and his children's children and his great-grandchildren get the message. Now, it is not good manner when I submit and leave my children or my grandchildren to go and scavenge for ideas, ideologies, and religions other than what Allah has sent to his prophets. This is not adab. This is not good manners. Good manners means you don't only submit, but you submit and bring those dependent of yours to also submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim, with his lengthy discussion with his father, after his father disowned him and condemned him and threatened him to stone him to death, he says, سَوْفَ أَسْتَغْفِرُ لَكَ رَبِّي. He did not assume things on Allah. He didn't take Allah for granted. He didn't say, I'm a prophet, I'm going to ask Allah, he's going to forgive you, don't worry about it. No. He doesn't assume. We assume a lot. We know a friend and we see his righteous behavior and we assume. We talk and say, he is in paradise. How do we know that? I am sure he is forgiven. How could we be sure of that? How do we speak for Allah when we do not know what the actual man's intentions are? We know one thing, that actions are counted and evaluated, factoring in the intention of the person. So you never hear the Prophet ﷺ sending somebody to paradise or to hellfire without communication with Allah. He would always refer to Allah and defer to Allah. So Ibrahim says to his father, I will ask Allah to forgive you. But then Allah corrects him. إِلَّا قَوْلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ لِأَبِيهِ لَأَسْتَغْفِرَنَّ لَكَ رَبِّي. Believers should not seek to ask Allah to do what is owed only to people who believe and act righteously. No one should ask Allah to reward them as he would a believer who has the commitment, the discipline, and the understanding, and the practice. You can't ask Allah. It is like, if I may just illustrate to get the point across, when a student doesn't do his homework, and he doesn't submit the homework, and he doesn't attend the final exam, how could you intercede with his teacher and tell him, give him an A? That is impolite, that is inappropriate, And that's against adab. It's against good manners. If you want to ask Allah for something, don't ask Him to change His rules. The rules are, وَأَن لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Man only gets what he earns. So don't ask Allah to give somebody what this somebody did not earn. Clear. So Ibrahim tells his dad, I will ask Allah to forgive you. And Allah says, no, no, no. Ibrahim didn't know yet that his father would never believe and as such would never qualify. So, and it is because Allah has given him a promise. Okay? What is the promise? The promise is a prophet's prayer is always answered. But even a prophet cannot ask Allah to change his laws, to change his rules, to bend his guidelines for the sake of anybody. That is adab, that is good manners. So we have to be careful. Ibrahim is taken after he destroyed those idols and he's put in fire. We know the story. Ibrahim does not even lift a hand to ask Allah for anything. He is so comfortable, he is so trusting that Allah will certainly take care of him. But listen to this, there is no record in the Quran or elsewhere that says that Allah told him, get into the fire and I will save you. That would not be a real test. The test is you go blindly, trusting Allah fully, and then you will discover that Allah is standing with you. Allah is picking you up. You will never fall fully to the floor if you believe in Allah and trust Him. So good manners include that level of trust. Whatever test, whatever trial Allah puts you through, trust Him to pick you up even before you fall. So they set the fire and Allah talks to the fire directly. وَقُلْنَا يَا نَارُ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٍ. Ibrahim is in the fire and he doesn't know what's going on. Allah is talking to the fire. How would he know? But then the fire immediately, because Ibrahim submitted immediately, the fire also submits likewise. You see, the distance between us and Allah is as far or as close as you want it to be. It's up to you. In the Hadith Qudsi, he who comes to me walking, I come to him running. He who comes to me running, I come to him in an instant. Look at how Allah is quite generous. You just take a small step and Allah will take care of the rest. This is faith. This is Islam. Your submission is your way to be saved, both in this life and in the hereafter. And when we say Islam is submission, we are talking about totality of our way of life. Not to submit to Him in prayer and disown Him in other things. Not to submit to Him in fasting and then disregard Him in business. Not to submit to Him socially, but disregard His guidance politically. The interests of the nation in which you live is part of your Islam. You are a member of a society and you are supposed to protect and keep that society together, safe and sound and in good direction. When you abandon the society in which you live or the family that Allah has entrusted you with, you abandon your Islam. Your Islam is not just an individual belief system that you keep in your head, activate when it is easy, when it is of interest, when it is beneficial, and then deactivate when you feel it is not. So you look at the rest of Ibrahim's life, and you will find that Allah tells him, slaughter your son. An amazing test for a father. As merciful as Ibrahim was. And not any father. This is a father who begot this son after 86 years of marriage. Mind you, that's not a young dad who is hopeful he can get 2-3 other kids. No. He doesn't even ask a question. A question he doesn't ask. He doesn't say how come. He doesn't say what if. He doesn't say what for. No question. He goes to his son. And I want you also to pay attention to the fact that this order came to Ibrahim in his dream. You look at the magnificent way that he raised a child who was a young man, and he was raised away from him. Ismail was raised away from his father. So when his father goes to visit him in Mecca, Allah tells him, slaughter your son. What an amazing command. What is Ibrahim actually commanded to slaughter is, when his love for his son, I want you to pay attention to this, became close to becoming a competition with his love of Allah, Allah wanted him to slaughter this love and to only keep the love of Allah. What is the price? I dare you to slaughter your son for my sake. I want you to do it. Do you have the courage? Do you understand what this command is? Ibrahim doesn't go into discussion. He understood what it means and he went ahead. Look at his son. The father raised him to be a believer. Look at the level of the faith of the child. He comes and he tells him, my son, Allah showed me in my dream. Listen to the accuracy of reporting. He doesn't say Allah commanded me. No, no, no. He says, Allah showed me in my dream. Huh? Anni azbahuk, that I am slaying you. I am slaughtering you. His son, raised by this kind of father, he knows. Ya abatif'al ma tu'mar. He understood what a dream of a prophet is. It is real. And it is reality, and it is from Allah. So, ya abatif'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha Allah min as-sabirin. You will find me a patient person throughout this process. You look at the father's response to Allah, you're amazed. You look at the response of the child to his father, more amazement. He doesn't tell him, oh dad, did you eat so much last night or what? Dad, take care of yourself when you go to sleep. There is no such discussion. There is no such questioning at all. He took him seriously and he knew that he is up to that serious challenge to his faith and trust, both in his father and in Allah. So the son is tested twice and he passes with flying colors. So فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ, when they both submitted to Allah and when the son laid his head on the bench to be slaughtered, Allah at that moment intervened. You see, the intervention of Allah only comes after your full unconditional submission, not before. And submission should never stop at accepting the word. Accepting the word is meant that you translate it into action. When you act upon your submission, then when it is critical, Allah will come in. When it is critical, Allah will come in. So Allah sends a lamb to save Ismail and gives a certificate to Ibrahim and Ismail that they were really certainly qualified to be righteous in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You look at Musa alayhi salam. Allah tells him, go. You and your brother go to Pharaoh. Going to Pharaoh at that time meant you are jumping not in an ocean, but in a volcano. Who would not be afraid? Anyone would be. So they both say in one breath, إِنَّنَا نَخَافُ أَيْ يَفْرُطَ عَلَيْنَا أَوْ أَيْ يَطْغَى. We're concerned, Allah, that this guy is going, he is reckless and he can kill us, he can do anything. Then Allah tells both of them, لَا تَخَافَ. Don't you both be afraid. لَا تَخَافَ. إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمَا. I am with you. I hear and I see. What do they do? No discussion. They go. What make them go? They believed what Allah said. إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمَا. I am with you. They believed that. Well, Allah told us, all the believers, He told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مُحْسِنُونَ. Allah is always with those who live by observing Allah all the time, by monitoring what they say and what they do. This is the rule. Our relationship with Allah is mutual. And this is an amazing type of relationship. God is not that distant from us that we seek to reach out to Him. He is so close. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was in the cave, and Abu Bakr was concerned for the safety of the Prophet. So he tells him, if these pagans look under their feet, they would see us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looks at him and he says, لا تحزن. Don't you grieve. Do not worry. Why? إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. Allah is with us. Allah in person. What else do you need? So the issue is, do you trust that Allah is with you? And how do I know that Allah is with me? Many people ask, how do I know? It's presumptuous. Not really. You know that Allah is with you if you love His book and love Him and love His Prophet. You know that Allah is with you when you connect with His book on a practical level, not on intellectual level alone. Allah is with you when you know that you love to do what is right and to stand for what is just, not only for you and your family and your kin and your neighbor, but for everybody, every human being deserves your support and your love and your care. If you are a good person, a good neighbor, a good colleague, a good contractor, a good businessman, a good doctor, if you give it your heart, that means that Allah is with you. If given choices between good and bad, and you always incline to do what is good, and you actually do it, that means not only Allah is with you, but Allah loves you. So there are certain signs and evidence that are tangible through which Allah tells us how close He is to us and how committed He is to our support and how much He loves us. But if you see your life in the opposite, you don't connect with the Quran at all. You come to prayer, but you come only reluctant or pushed or somebody pulling you or bringing you in. Otherwise, you don't show up. If you have choices between good and evil, you choose evil because it's either convenient or pleasant or easy. Many people say, when asked,
Why don't you pray on regular times? They say it's not easy. Well, the path to paradise is made easy by Allah to those who seek it out. Allah will never put anything on your way to paradise if your objective is salvation of self and everyone around you. If your objective is peace for yourself and comfort for your family and peace and comfort for every human being you get in touch with, that means not only Allah is close to you, not only Allah supporting you, but Allah is showing you His ultimate love and care. So there are ways. So Musa and Harun, they go to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh threatens not only Musa, not only Pharaoh, but their community, their supporters, the children of Israel. لَأُقَطْعَنَّ أَيْدِيَهُمْ وَأَرْجُلَهُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ. All of those threats, I will cut their limbs right and left, up and down, and I will kill them and I will crucify them. What do they say? What does Musa say? What does he do? His level of trust and confidence in Allah bring him not only comfort for himself, but for his community. But unfortunately, his community was a community of rebellious members. So when Pharaoh threatens, Musa is not shaken. He says, maybe Allah will empower you and will destroy your enemies. And as He empowers you, He's going to be putting you in a test as to how much committed you are to Him. They answer him and say, أُوذِينَا مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن تَأْتِيَنَا وَمِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جِئْتَنَا. We have been living in this misery before you came and after you came. Meaning, you are meaningless for us. How could any decent community speak like this to their prophet? But Moses, while he was upset, he never abandoned his community. Why? Because he trusts Allah to deliver him and the believers. And when the earth was shaken under their feet, he looks up to Allah and he says, oh Allah, if you had willed it, you would have done it early on when they displayed a lot more rebellion against you. But he comes back and says, إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا فِتْنَتُكَ تُضِلُّ بِهَا مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَهْدِي مَنْ تَشَاءُ. It is only your testing and your trial. You test whom you will and you save whom you will. You guide whom you will. So the language is a language of submission, a language of obedience. Finally, we go back to one of those ultimate examples in the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when he went to the city of At-Ta'if, about 90 kilometers away from Mecca, and he was rejected, he was stoned by the mob and the children and the ignorant, and he resorts to a tree to sit down in the shade of a tree in the heat of the sun. And he raises his hands up to Allah. What does he say? What does he submit? He submits his full submission to Allah. That's what he submits. أنت ربي ورب المستضعفين. Oh Allah, you are my Lord, and you are the Lord and the protector of every and any helpless person. Huh? And then he asks Allah to show him the way. And Allah sends, by way of a test, the angel that controls the mountains. And he tells him, if you ask, Allah gave me the permission to crush them between these two mountains. Merciful, compassionate as he was, he says, no. Maybe Allah will bring from their own offspring a generation that would worship Allah and associate no one with Him. His eyes were focused on one thing only, guiding people and picking people away from hellfire. That was his mission. His mission was not to force people to believe or crush them if they don't. His mission was to save people. through their own volition, just by presenting and educating and teaching. No forcing, no coercion, nothing. So he says no. And in his suffering, his heel was bleeding. And he was desperate, but he does not talk desperate to Allah. He doesn't use desperate language. He concludes this lengthy prayer and submission by saying, "Oh Allah, if you're not angry with me, there is nothing for me to worry about. The only thing that worries me is if you're letting these guys do this to me by way of punishment, that you're angry with me. Otherwise, I don't mind." This is not only submission, this is adab, this is good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the best of manners and make us follow his prophets.
Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna sayyidina wa lana muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa ba'd.
As we have seen, and the examples are too many to count them all, but you could go and read the Quran, read the stories of the prophets, how they listened to Allah, how they responded to Allah, how they reacted to Allah's commands, how they made prayer, how they asked Allah for things, for support, for provision, for anything. What was their focus? What was important in their eyes? Those lessons could teach us to develop and insist on having good manners, good adab with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, as we are talking about good manners with Allah, the last example we gave for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his keen protection for those who did not only believe, disbelieve in him and deny him and reject him, but those who even tortured him and punished him for him teaching them their faith. Then it behooves us as good manners with Allah that we care for his creation the same way the prophets did. All the prophets were keen to save their communities. We also must be keen to save our nation, to save our neighbors. And by saving, I do not mean proselytizing. I don't mean lecturing them to death. I mean helping them until they are helped. Loving them until they love you back. Caring for them until they are safe and good and healthy. This is what saving people is about. It is not about converting them to Islam. That is a choice Allah gave them. But it's about communicating the message in action. In your love, in your compassion, you are a better teacher than 20,000 lectures that you could give. People are not impressed by talk. Anybody could talk. But people do understand a loving heart and a kind hand and a caring spirit. This is what people are looking for. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا، ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا غائبا إلا رددته، ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان، اللهم انتصر للإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم عليك بأعدائك أعداء الدين، اللهم خذهم بددا وأحصهم عددا ولا تبق منهم أحدا إلا إن شئت أن يهتدوا فاهدهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب، فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد.